After the least successful film in the franchise, and then a 6-year absence, Bond returned in GoldenEye, to a world that may not have wanted him, a world without a Berlin Wall, and a world without a Soviet Union. Bringing back and modernizing Bond with a new actor, no less, was a pretty big risk that definitely paid off. GoldenEye revitalized the franchise, but would Eon pull it off with the follow-up, Tomorrow Never Dies? Well, yeah, actually they would at that. The movie opens with Bond covertly spying on a terrorist arms bazaar, which is being watched by M, and an American counterpart, Admiral Roebuck, played by Jeffrey Palmer, who, despite M's insistence that Bond handle this, just wants to blow all these terrorists and their weapons up and fires 2 missiles at the site. Too late, they realize that there's a couple of nukes there, and Bond hijacks a nearby plane and escapes. It's a thrilling sequence, and although it doesn't seem to have much to do with the plot of the rest of the film, the terrorist, Henry Gupta, played by Ricky Jay, wound up making off with a GPS encoder, which would wind up in the hands of the film's main villain, Elliot Carver, played by Jonathan Pryce. Carver is often compared with Rupert Murdoch, and while that's somewhat silly, as I doubt the head of Fox is going around doing shit like this, there are some similarities in their empire. Carver is a worldwide media baron whose main claim to fame is a newspaper called Tomorrow. It seems to be getting the news of world events out faster than any other media source. Of course, because Carver isn't instigating these media events. As an interesting note, the original title of the film was Tomorrow Never Lies, but after someone typoed it as Tomorrow Never Dies, Eon decided they liked that better and went with it. Anyway, Carver uses the GPS encoder to fool a British frigate into thinking it's in international waters, when actually it was encroaching on Chinese waters, which causes a conflict. Carver even has his ruthless henchman Stamper, played by Gotz Otto, machine gun the frigate's survivors, just to make the Chinese look like bigger assholes. Stamper is cut from the same cloth as previous Bond henchmen, such as Red Grant and Negros. Large, blonde, and dangerous. And you know when a big blonde henchman shows up, there's bound to be a memorable fight scene between him and Bond near the end of the movie. Of course, there's the fact that Carver is creating the news, and it doesn't exactly go unnoticed by the worldwide intelligence community, and Bond is sent to investigate. Knowing he had at one point had a relationship with Carver's wife Paris, played by Terry Hatcher, M sends Bond to pump her for information. I have to note at this point, Terry fucking Hatcher. The bitch who played Lois Lane on that shitty Superman show. Yeah. Well, she may not be the worst Bond girl ever. Ugh. She can't act her way out of a paper bag. Anyway, Bond shows up at one of Carver's parties posing as a banker and bones Paris thoroughly. She runs away with him and helps him sneak her into her husband's headquarters and steal back the GPS encoder. Carver, of course, doesn't like this very much and has Paris killed by this creepy guy Dr. Kaufman, played by Vincent Chiavelli. He kind of reminded me of Peter Lorre in the very first Bond movie, Casino Royale. Well, anyway, Bond kills the bad guy and escapes using his awesome car, which is one of the best ones he ever used. I think Goldfinger, The Spy Who Loved Me, and this film have the best cars. Well, Bond then sets off to Hong Kong, where he meets and teams up with the main Bond girl of the film, a Chinese spy named Wai Lin, played by Michelle Yeoh. They find there's a missile missing from the sunken frigate and then get captured, though together they escape. Realizing that Carver is starting a major global conflict so he could report on it and control the media, Bond and Wai Lin contact the opposing Chinese and British forces, telling them to hold off on killing each other until they could prove that Carver's radar invisible boat is out there messing with their devices. They contact Jack Wade, who helps them jump down to where the ship is, which they then infiltrate. Bond blows up part of the ship, causing it to be visible to radar, and Wai Lin gets herself captured, and Carver uses her as a shield. Bond attempts to do the same thing with Gupta, but Carver is a cold son of a bitch and just shoots Gupta. All hell breaks loose, and Carver stupidly tries to fight Bond and gets himself owned by his own industrial drill. Then Bond fights Stamper, of course, and manages to win, destroy the warhead, and Bond and Wai Lin escape, and the British and Chinese blow the fuck out of the stealth ship. Although some consider Tomorrow Never Dies to be disappointing, I rather like this one, and I would go so far as to say it's almost as good as GoldenEye. Although the villains in this film aren't as interesting or menacing as in previous Bond films, the media angle makes a lot of sense these days, and I personally think Carver is a villain with more realistic goals, as opposed to someone like Hugo Drax. There were also quite a lot of action in this movie, and even some kung fu scenes with Wai Lin. The film strikes a delicate balance between the seriousness of films such as The Living Daylights, the action from films such as GoldenEye, and the humor, as in the Roger Moore films. A common criticism is that Tomorrow Never Dies is generic, but honestly, when a film franchise reaches 21 films based on the same basic premise, the creators have to work pretty damn hard to keep things fresh, and can often resort to cheesy gimmicks, something that they definitely did not do here. Tomorrow Never Dies is a solid successor to GoldenEye, and deserving of the 9 out of 10 I gave.